Hello, my lovely friends. My name is Ava, and today we're going to be talking about the books that I ended up reading in November. So I actually already filmed the first part of my November wrap-up a few videos ago. It's called my November mid-month wrap-up. I will also link it down below if you want to click that link. But I talk about the first, I think, either 9 or 10 books that I read earlier this month. And so this video is just going to be me talking about all of the rest of, I read 13 books for the second half of November. So we're going to be talking about those books today. I read a lot of novellas, so just fair warning. I also read a few Christmas books, so let's dive right on into these books. Okay, so the book that I ended up reading directly after the last book that I read in the last video is Bayou Bruiser by Jessa Kane. This is one of Jessa Kane's most recent releases, and if you didn't know about Jessa Kane, she is the steamy novella queen. So yes, this is a romance novella. This is the romance between Benny and Fawn. Benny is this big, broody dude who unalives people for a living, and Fawn is a very sweet, innocent heroine who has been locked in her father's basement for quite a long time. And so Benny has been tasked by his boss to go unalive her father, not knowing that he has a daughter, but just he's in the wrongs with Benny's boss. And so Benny goes over there to do what he's asked. And when he's there, he sees that Fawn is in the basement, locked up in his basement. And right when he sees her, he knows that he is going to keep her. He has a hard time justifying if she would want to stay with him in return, though, even though Fawn is totally dedicated to him. Right when she sets eyes on him, she wants him. And he has a little bit of a hard time believing that. This was, of course, hot, fun, like any Jessa Kane novella, or most Jessa Kane novellas. She does have some flops for me personally. I know whenever I'm slumpy, like I was a little bit during this month, I can definitely pick up a Jessa Kane to just fly through in one sitting, and they're entertaining and fun. I really like this one. However, like many Jessa Kane novellas, it would be perfect, and like I would love it if it was a full-length book. Like if we just delved deeper and she did a full-length story, like it would have been awesome. However, there are some novellas that she's written that I just want more, that I don't feel satisfied enough. She has written novellas that I have felt satisfied of, so this unfortunately was not one of those satisfied novellas for me. I ended up giving this book a 3.5 out of 5 stars. I then read the third book in the Mackenzies and McBride series, which is The Many Sins of Lord Cameron by Jennifer Ashley. This is about a couple named, the hero's name is Cameron and the heroine's name is Ainsley. The two of them met about 6 years ago when Ainsley was sneaking into his room to steal something at like a party, and he comes across her and they share this kiss, but she breaks it off because she is married and she doesn't want to bring shame on her and her husband, so she leaves. And throughout the 6 years since that occurrence, they have always been in the back of their mind, like the other person, they've always like popped into their brain every now and then. During the present time, the two of them come in contact once again because she is again stealing something from his room, and she comes across Cameron in a very compromising position with another woman. Let me just say, Cameron is not happy about the fact that this woman has sneaked into his room twice to steal something from him. However, this time around, the second time that they see each other, Ainsley is now a widow, and so she is available. And so the two of them just cannot keep their hands off of one another, but for certain reasons, and because Cameron has this dark, brooding past, he cannot let himself have perfect Ainsley. I love Jennifer Ashley. I think she's an amazing author, an amazing historical romance author. Her books are just so realistic to me. Even though they're taking place in a time period I know almost nothing about, I really got sucked into this story and was like giggling like a schoolgirl finally when Ainsley and Cam put their differences aside and put their past behind them and finally got together. I really liked this one, and I can't wait to read the rest in this series as well. There are a few trigger warnings in here, by the way. So we have domestic abuse, sexual assault, infant loss, and there is mention of suicide. I ended up giving this one a 4 to 5 stars just because this isn't my favorite ever, and there are definitely better ones in this series. Book one, The Madness of Lord Ian McKenzie, being that one. I read another historical romance. I was in a very much historical romance mood this month. We have Seduction of a Highland Lass by Maya Banks. This is the second book in the McCabe trilogy. So the first one I read earlier this month, so I talk about it in that mid-month wrap-up for November. So I believe each book is centered around three brothers and you meet them in book one. And so this is the romance between Alaric and Keeley. I love the premise of this book so much. It has so many of my favorite tropes. Like it was very good. So Alaric, he is being sent by his brother to go marry a neighboring clan so that they can be in an alliance with one another. However, on his way to go propose to this woman he barely knows, he gets ambushed. He and his men get ambushed, and he is the only survivor, and he is basically knocked out, bleeding wounds all over him, but he's still hanging onto his horse, and his horse runs away, and the horse ends up traveling a long distance and appears in front of this cottage in the middle of nowhere. And that is where Keely lives. Keely has actually been cast out by the clan that he was about to go to. She's been cast out from that clan because of the horrible clan leader. And so she sees him and she nurses him back to health. And through her nursing him back to health, he starts to fall in love with her. He calls her his angel at times because she's saving him from death, but then at other times he'll scorn her and call her that she's a devil of a woman because she'll yell at him to like, get up, I need to help you, you are not cooperating with me, and like, you need to wake up. Like, she yells at him at points because he's not listening to her. So then he calls her a devil of a woman, but then sometimes he calls her an angel of a woman, and he's like in this pain haze, like he is almost completely knocked out except for those few words. Alaric's brothers end up finding him finally and end up taking him and Keely back to their keep, and where she is to take care of him and help the birth of the baby that was conceived in book one, you know, like the baby from book one in the series. So she is helping two people mainly in here. I loved this one. I did. I love how the two of them fully fell in love with one another, and you fully got to see that on page, and especially through the caretaking scenes in here. If you don't know, caretaking is one of my favorite tropes of all time, and that was in spades galore throughout this book. I also love this family. I love the McCabe family and how much they welcomed Keely in with open arms. This clan fully loved Keely as well and totally embraced her. There was something that happened at the end that was kind of like an ambushy thing. I'm not gonna talk about spoilers, but there was something that happened at the end that wasn't really explained. They didn't find the culprit behind the thing that happened. And so I am hoping that it gets revealed in the last book in the series, and I would love to know what happens. And if it doesn't get revealed in the last book in the series, I'm gonna be really confused as to why that even happened in book two, at the end of book two. But yeah, I really enjoyed this one. There is a trigger warning in here for attempted sexual assault by obviously not the hero, from somebody else. So yeah, there's caretaking scenes in here galore. So if you want a caretaking romance, this one is definitely one to read. I ended up giving this one a 5 out of 5 stars. I then read A Warm Heart in Winter by J.R. Ward, which is book number 18.5 in the Black Dagger Brotherhood series. So yeah, we're on 18.5. Y'all. But this book is perfect for the wintry Christmas season because this takes place during a snowstorm, so all of the vampires, a part of the Black Dagger Brotherhood, are all snowed in the mansion. And so there's just a bunch of things that happen in here. I'm not gonna go too deep into it because it is book number 18.5, you know? And some of you may not know what the Black Dagger Brotherhood series is. It's a vampire romance series centered around mates and everything. And the Black Dagger Brotherhood is a group of vampires who protect the vampire race from these evil creatures you learn about in the series. I thought this was a great continuation to the story. I loved this book. It centers around specifically Blay and Quinn, who have already had their book, but it's kind of like a novella, even though it's not the length of a novella at all. But it kind of like goes back to their story and just adds on more to it. I love Blay and Quinn. They're one of my favorite couples in the entire series. They're just so swoony. I love them. This was a very emotional read though. It had its highs and it had its lows. It had this cute moments and then it had its sob worthy moments. I cannot go into specifics because I don't want to spoil anything, but you definitely need to read these books in order or you won't understand basically anything going on in this book. The trigger warnings in here is there is a death of a family member, and there's also a trigger warning for suicide, so please be aware of those before going in. But I really liked this, and I really liked how J.R. Ward added this book to the series. I ended up giving this book a 4 out of 5 stars just because, again, it's not my favorite thing ever, and I believe there are better books in this series. Okay, the next book that I read is called Call Me Maybe by Cara Bastone. Holy crapola. This book was good. I loved this. I knew I was gonna love this. I adore Cara Bastone. I've given almost every single book that I've read by her so far 5 stars. And this is another 5 star for the list. So this audiobook is honestly a piece of art. You need to read this on audio or listen to it on audio. If you are not into audiobooks, this book will get you into audiobooks, but it might also spoil you for audiobooks because not all audiobooks are like this. So there are two narrators, one for the character of Vera, the heroine, and one for the character of Cal, the hero in here. There's also some special effects sounds too, and it's just so stinking cool. So this is a over the phone romance. Vera is having some issues with the website she is creating, and Cal is one of the people on the customer service line for the website company. And they end up talking, and they end up talking for like 9 hours while he's trying to fix her website. And they talk about the website, obviously, they talk about random things, they talk about life, and the two of them start falling for each other a little bit over the phone. Cara Bastione is just a flipping amazing author. She knows how to suck you in and she knows how to make you believe in a romance, that this thing is like actually true, that this romance actually happened, that these characters are real. So if you're wanting to read a new author, Cara Bastione is definitely the one to read. I just adored this audiobook listening experience. When this was done, I was literally squealing because the ending just had butterflies in my stomach, and I want more about this couple, and I wish we got more, you know? Like, this is 5 stars for me. I loved this, but I do want more just because I'm a stickler. Like, I want more. This book had some great banter. It has some cute funny pets in here too, a sweet cinnamon roll hero. This was great. If you want to read and listen to an amazing book, please pick up Call Me Maybe. I will tell you, there's no steam or spice in here. If you just want a cute as heck romance, this is the one to listen to. Next, I read Beast in the Cage by Tammy Walsh. I downloaded this off of Kindle Unlimited. This, I'm not gonna talk too much into this because this was honestly just a mediocre romance for me. And I hate that because I'm trying to find new alien romance books that I can love, because alien romances are like my favorite subgenre of romance. And unfortunately, like almost all of the new ones that I've been reading that aren't like Ruby Dixon or authors that I already love that write alien romances, they fall flat for me. And this was one of those. Our heroine in here, she is a human woman. She ends up getting abducted by aliens, and she gets put as a prize in this gladiator arena. So every time a alien gladiator on this planet wins a fight, they end up having the option to pick a prize. And the prize is always a woman to spend the night with them, and then they go back to the prize room, prize cell. And so our hero in here, he is the ultimate fighter. He has never lost a fight, and he has also never chosen a prize. He has never picked a woman out until our heroine comes, and he sees her, and he picks her out, and he brings her back to his place, and they end up just talking the entire night together. And then she gets put back to the cell in the morning, and then he ends up fighting his battles just so he can be with her and see her every single day after he wins. The romance between Ivy and Kren at the beginning was really great. However, it didn't pan out the way that I expected. You know, like that seems very cute and awesome, like the summary I just told you. However, it doesn't like really go out that way, you know? I saw the twist coming literally from page one when we met the evil person, and I did not care. I didn't care at all. The parts where they had conflict with this evil person was so boring to me, and I didn't like how our heroine had to lie to the hero at points because of things. I don't want to spoil things, but she did have to lie to our hero. I just don't like when one of the people from the couples in romance have to lie to each other, because honesty is like my number one priority, or one of my number one priorities in relationships at all. And so it really grinds on my gears when that happens in romances. So this one just wasn't really it for me. There's a trigger warning in here for sexual assault if you do want to read this one. I mean, go ahead. Every person has different tastes, so you might like this one. It wasn't my thing, unfortunately. I gave this book a 2 out of 5 stars. I then reread another Ice Planet Barbarian book. I reread Barbarian's Mine by Ruby Dixon, which is some people's favorites in the series, and I totally get why. This is the 7th book in the Ice Planet Barbarian series, and this one is a romance between Josie and Hayden. If you didn't know about the Ice Planet Barbarian series, look it up. Everyone should probably know what it is by now. It's an alien romance series that I adore. This is a hate to love romance. Josie at this point is the only human woman who does not have a mate yet with one of the aliens. And finally, at the beginning of this book, her IUD falls out. And with your, on this planet, you're not able to find your mate unless you are able to procreate. And so she's finally able to procreate, and her body is like, okay, let's find your mate. Let's do it. And then she realizes that her mate is the one alien in the entire tribe that she cannot stand, and who bickers with her all the time. And like, she thinks that he is this awful person, when actuality he is not. And she learns that throughout the book. And they go on a little bit of a adventure together to go do something, and they're bickering the whole time, and one of them might almost die and reveal their feelings for one another afterward. Like, it has a lot of tropes that people love in this one, and I totally get why this is some people's favorites in the series, because It's pretty good, okay? I really enjoyed this one. 5 stars, of course. I loved this reread. Then I read a short story. I completed the Wild Season series by Christina Lauren a couple months ago or last month. I don't remember when I finished it. But I realized that there's a short story. So this is book number 4.5 in the series. It's a very short story. It's like on their website. On Christina Lauren's website, I think you just search Not Joe's Not So Short Story and it'll pop up and you can just read it online, and that's what I did on their website. This one, I just gave 3 stars. Not my favorite at all. This is a romance between Not Joe, who you read about in the series. I can't really talk about this book all that much because it's about characters you've already met and it's a short story, so you're not supposed to know all these other characters. And so he was introduced in the previous books, and then it's his romance with Perry, who is the ex to the guy from book one, who was an absolute witch in book one. So I didn't really care for reading about her. I really liked Not Joe. That's why I like this book has 3 stars at least, because I like Not Joe. And then this wasn't really that long, and it like ended at a point where I was like, that's it. That's all we're gonna get. So this was unfortunately just 3 stars for me. I then read Queen Takes Rose by Katie Robert. This is the 6th and last book, I believe, last book in the Wicked Villain series. And this is a reimagining of Sleeping Beauty, and it's the romance between Aurora and Malone, who represents Maleficent. So Aurora and Malone are in this deal. Malone purchases Aurora for 2 weeks from Hades, the runner of the, I forget what the club is called, but the club that Aurora works at. So Aurora is staying with Malone for 2 weeks, and she gets to do whatever she wants to her. And Aurora agrees to this, by the way. And Malone and Aurora have been like tiptoeing around each other at this club for a little bit. And then Malone finally does something about it and finally wants to get Aurora out of her system, but she doesn't know that Aurora agreed to this whole transaction because she wants to unalive Malone. Because Malone doesn't know that she is the reason why Aurora's mother has been in a coma for many, many, many years. And so she's there to seek retribution for her mother. I really liked this romance. Unfortunately, it was not my favorite in the series by far. And honestly, that's okay. You can't love every single book in a series, I don't think. Unless they're very rarely you get to do that. But I did enjoy this one for what it was. There were things in here that bugged me a little bit. Like Malone's family is from Sabine Valley, which is another series by Katie Robert that I believe she was writing at the same time as this book. And so it mentions Sabine Valley way too much for my liking. It was more setting up the Sabine Valley series than it was focusing on this book specifically in this romance. And like, I just didn't care for that. I want to be in this book. I want to be in this romance, in this story. I don't want to really be reading about a different series I didn't sign up for going in. There is a trigger warning in here for death of a loved one, so please be aware of that. But overall, I just gave this book a 4 out of 5 stars. Next, I read Wyvern by Grace Draven. Finally, I've been wanting to read this for forever. I love Grace Draven so much. She's one of my favorite authors of all time. This is a fantasy romance novella, and it is a shifter novella. Elsbeth, I think that's how you say her name. I'm going to call her Beth, because the hero calls her Beth. She is a very talented fiddler in this fantasy land, and she's been tasked by the village that she lives in to go make a deal with the dragon that lives on the edge of their village to make sure that the dragon doesn't attack them. But right when she meets the Wyvern and sees the Wyvern, she realizes that the Wyvern reminds her of her long-lost love that she lost 8 years ago and hasn't seen since. And so then she starts to wonder whether or not the Wyvern creature that she sees in front of her could also be the man that she fell in love with many years ago. This was just magical. I loved this. I love Grace Draven. I love dragon shifters. I love shifters in general. This is a second chance romance. I don't want to spoil it, but you can kind of put 2 and 2 together of who the Wyvern is and who her long lost love is. I wish that this was a full length book, honestly, because I feel like it would have been flipping amazing. And I feel like she kind of did that a little bit with Dragon Unleashed that she wrote. I believe she wrote Wyvern before she wrote Dragon Unleashed, and Dragon Unleashed is about a woman falling in love with a dragon shifter as well. And so like, we kind of got something like that, but we don't have this kind of storyline, this second chance romance. I wish it was longer. I wanted more. I wish she continued with this couple in another book, because they would have been amazing and I want to read about them more. And the ending was just so good. I loved it. Trigger warnings in here is that there is sickness and death of a loved one, so please be aware of that. But I just adored this, and I thought this was a great one. However, I did just give it 4 stars because I've read books that I love more by Grace Draven, honestly. But if you want a very short and magical novella, this one is definitely one to read. Okay, so I'm going to talk about 3 Christmas novellas that I read slash listened to at the end of the month. First, I have The Naughty List by Ellie Mae McGregor. So this is about Kate, and she feels a little bit down this Christmas, okay? But then on Christmas Eve, she ends up waking up to see Santa in front of her. Like, she sees Santa. But he's not your stereotypical looking Santa. This guy is big. He has like a scruffy beard, and he's tall, tattooed, and honestly very attractive. Right when this Santa sees Kate, he knows he wants her. This is so fun. If you want a fun Christmas novella that's really hot, please pick this one up, and a couple of the ones I'm gonna talk about in a second too. I really love Ellie Mae McGregor's writing style. I read The Witch's Wolves by her earlier last month or the month before that, and I really liked that one too. I love her writing style, and I can't wait to read more of her books, and I thought this was just so fun. If you want a very short, fun novella to get you out of a slump or get your mind on Christmas, pick this one up. I gave this one a 4 to 5 stars. Then I listened to The Christmas Pact by Vi Keeland and Penelope Ward. This was another book that was available to me off of Audible Plus that I could just download and listen to very quickly. This was like a 3-hour audiobook, and it was shorter based off of me speeding up the book. So this is about Riley Kennedy and Kennedy Riley. They end up working at the same publishing company, and sometimes their emails get mixed up because they have the same name but backwards. And so the two of them are forced to interact with one another when they have to send their email to the correct person. Sometimes Kennedy reads Riley's emails before he sends them back to her and gives her advice and snarky comments, and she cannot stand it or him. But then something happens to where the two of them need a fake date for Christmas, their Christmas parties, and the hero is actually going to a wedding. So basically the two of them need fake dates for the family engagements that they have around Christmas time. And so the two of them get roped into each other to be their fake date. When they start spending more time together, they start realizing that there is a fine line between love and hate. The audiobook is great. I adore Sebastian York and Andy Arndt, and these are the narrators of this book, and they're my two favorite audiobook narrators. I adore them. They honestly bring the characters to life so well in their audio narration, and I thought this was super fun but also emotional at times. So there are emotional instances in here, and if you want just a very wholesome Christmas read to listen to, this one is definitely one to pick up if you want to listen to it more around the Christmas time. I will warn you, there is no steam in here, just like Call Me Maybe by Cara Bastone. It's very short. There's no steam in it, but the romance is so realistic and very tension heavy. So yeah, I really enjoyed this one. I gave it 4 stars. It was a very enjoyable, very fun read. Okay, the last Christmas book I'm gonna talk about right now is Santa Baby by Cassie Mint. I read a Cassie Mint book last month called Pool Girl, and oh my gosh, I adored that novella. It was so fun. And I thought I would love this one too. So this one's about Clara and Jack. Jack hired Clara a couple years ago to work in his bar, in the bar that he owns. And ever since he has hired her, she has a huge crush on him. And she doesn't know that Jack also has feelings for her. However, there is an age gap between the two, so he's never like admitted his feelings for her because he feels like he's too old for her. But then on Christmas Eve, things start to happen between them and they start to reveal their feelings for one another. I thought this was super fun, hot, a very entertaining Christmas read. This one definitely hit the spot for my need for hot Christmas novellas for sure. If you have any more for me to read, a hot, steamy Christmas novella, leave them down below for me, please, because I want them. I honestly, for this one, just wanted more character development. The other Christmassy novellas I talked about, I felt like had more character development, and I feel like those books satisfied me more than this one, unfortunately. But again, that's what you're gonna get with a novella. They're very short, so I'll take what I can get. I gave this one a 3.5 out of 5 stars. Okay, the last book that I read was the book that I finished literally almost at midnight on the last day of November. We have The Professional by Cressley Cole, the first book in the Game Maker series. I love Cressley Cole. I've read all of her books in the Immortals After Dark series, which are over 15 books. I want to say 18 books, maybe? Close to 20. I love that series, and so I thought that I was gonna love this book because I just adore Cressley Cole's writing style. So this is a mafia romance, a Russian mafia romance between Sebastian and Natalie. So Natalie is in the States. She's adopted. She was adopted as a baby, but she has always been wanting to find her birth parents. And so she sends a private investigator out to find them. Through her doing this, she meets Sebastian, who reveals to her that she is the daughter of a very powerful mafia Russian mob boss. And so Sebastian ends up taking her from her home and bringing her to Russia to meet her biological father. But once the two of them like meet each other, they cannot stop thinking about one another at all. Their attraction grows, their tension grows for sure, and so does the angst. But Sebastian has been ordered by her father to protect Natalie at all costs, even if that means protecting her from himself. I enjoyed this one. Unfortunately, I didn't love it. There are things in here that really grind my gears. I'm not that big of a fan of the two characters in here, honestly. I didn't really care for Natalie, and I didn't really care for Sebastian. The saving grace was Cressley Cole's writing style, honestly. And I was mainly reading this book so I could read the other books in the series because people have told me how much they love the other books in the series, you know? Sebastian was not my favorite hero at all. I'm not the kind of person to absolutely adore a overbearing, very controlling alpha hero, and that is what Sebastian is. He's one of the most frustrating heroes I've ever read about, ever. I'm glad his book is done. I just want to read the rest of the series. So I just gave this one a 3 out of 5 stars. It was okay, but the saving grace in here was simply because Cressley Cole wrote this book. So there you have it. Those are the books that I read for the second half of November. Please let me know down below if you have read any of these books or if you plan to. And if you've made it this far, leave me a dragon emoji because I talked about a dragon book in here. So anyways, thank y'all so much for watching. I will see y'all soon in my next one. Bye, y'all.